So, instead of showing that our different infinite tensor products are different, maybe I go directly to the more interesting question for us, namely whether we can use this for giving or for providing different representations, inequivalent representations of our CCR relations. So I want to do as an example maybe, also showing this idea of superselection rules, maybe the most interesting calculation for us in this context, which gives us inequivalent representations of the CCR relations for an infinite number of degree of freedom. And of course, I mean, those representations are irreducible, huh? So it's not that they are inequivalent because it is different direct sums of one basic irreducible ones. Good. Okay, so and the idea was that we should take the representation for one degree of freedom and just take an infinite tensor product of this. So let us start from the one-dimensional one. So consider, and there we had our basic representation, which we call the Schrödinger representation for the CCR for one degree of freedom. And so maybe how was this given? So the form, the Hilbert space was, to make it concrete, was the L2 of R. But now I'm not writing down the P and the Q, but the important point, or yeah, maybe also to go to the infinite situation was to take the creation and annihilation operators. Huh? So we instead of P and Q, I'm now looking on A and A star, which satisfies the commutation relation A plus, the commutator between A and A plus or A star. I mean, they are unbounded operators, but this is the adjoint of this. This is equal to 1. Huh? This was the rewriting of the CCR in this relation. And the point, the main property of this Schrödinger representation was that we have there a specific vacuum vector. And of course, the point of the Stone von Neumann uniqueness theorem was to show that in any representation we find this vector. Huh? But here it was very concrete or very directly given. But so the point was we have a vector which is annihilated by all the A's. Huh? So we have a specific vector, unit vector in our Hilbert space, such that A acting on this annihilates this, and then we can generate the whole Hilbert space by just applying the creation operators to those guys. So we apply creation powers of the creation operator to omega, and then we get vectors, which let me call them now psi n. So psi n is the n-fold application of the creation operator to omega. And now I want to normalize it because I want unit vectors. So I also normalize this by 1 over the square root of n factorial. So this is then a norm 1 vector. And maybe if you look back to what we did when we talked about this, then the psi n, what I'm calling psi n now, was there the Fn's in 7.4. Okay, but I don't want to confuse it with the f's which I had in my tensor product, so let me call it now psi n. So those are vectors in this Hilbert space H here. And from this I get now easy representation of the canonical commutation relations for one degree of freedom. So now, maybe I draw a kind of picture here. So what I have here is now the canonical commutation relations of one degree of freedom, and maybe I draw it in a picture-like form. So I mean, I have here my vectors, I have the vacuum, which is psi 0 in this language here, and then I have psi 1 and psi 2, and the effect of the creation and annihilation operator between them is very easily described. And in physical terms, this thing here is called the harmonic oscillator because, one thinks of this corresponds to a situation where I'm sitting in a potential. So maybe I draw the picture like this. So I draw here a quadratic potential, but I mean it doesn't really matter. Huh? It's just to draw a nice picture. And so what I really need are the states which I have here, which I can draw like this. So I have the vacuum, which is psi 0. Then I have here psi 1. I have here psi 2. I have here psi 2, psi 3. So this is 2. This is 3. So this just is gives me a basis in my Hilbert space, and the action of the creation and annihilation operator is that I'm just going up and down. So the creation operator, of course, goes up. So it out of psi 2, it makes me a psi 3 with some normalization factor, and the A goes down. The annihilation operator goes down. And of course, if I'm in a vacuum, the annihilation operator gives 0, and the annihilation operator gives 0, and the creation operator goes from the vacuum to psi 1, and so on. So this is just a graphical representation of my vectors which I have and the action of the A between them. So this is my representation of the CCR for one degree of freedom, and now the idea was that I should take infinite tensor product of this to realize the a representation in the infinite case. So the idea is, what we want to do is realize the CCR in the case of infinite degree of freedom. Realize this as an infinite tensor product. It's an infinite tensor product of this. Good, but now, as we have seen, so I mean, I should take an infinite tensor product of the underlying Hilbert space, so of this Hilbert space H, and but now we know we have actually different choices for taking the infinite tensor product. And so these choices correspond to choosing vectors in my Hilbert spaces H1, H2, and so on. Of course, now all the H's are the same. I take the infinite tensor product of this underlying Hilbert space H, and so for each vector in the tensor product, I should choose one vector from this Hilbert space, and now I'm just choosing always the same vector. But of course, I can now choose which vector. I can choose any vector I like in my Hilbert space, any unit vector, but of course I have a basis here, so maybe this is a good choice, and so I can take any vector of those as my tensor product. And of course, those guys are very different from each other. So this means I should now get different tensor products. And the idea is that also my representations should then be very different. So I take here this infinite tensor product, but we can make different choices for this. We can make different choices. And now I make specific choices. So of course, so first of all, we take all the H's are now the same. I take one Hilbert space with one representation, which I want to tensor infinitely often. So the H_i's are all the same for all I in N. And now we should also choose an EI, which should live in the ith Hilbert space, but of course this is always the same. So I should, for each I, I should make a choice of a unit vector in my Hilbert space H, and I'm choosing them all the same. But which one I choose, this is now something which will give me different possibilities. So I'm choosing the EI as all the same, but equal to psi n, and I can make here different choices for n. So for all I'm choosing the same vector, but this vector does now depend on n. So I can fix this n. So for a fixed n in n. And then I get different, I can take the tensor product, the infinite tensor product, with respect to this data, and then of course I get something which will depend on this n. And so I get this infinite tensor product, and I denote this by kn, just to show on what it depends. So I put now kn. This is this infinite tensor product of the hi ei for this choice, where the eis are all this psi n. So this is this infinite tensor product. All the h's are the same. And the vector which I choose there is also always the same, but of course it depends on n. Huh? So it's psi n. Yeah, okay, so this gives us a Hilbert space, which has this canonical tensor product structure. And then we can also realize our operators on this space. So we can now, so I mean, our operators, the A and the A star, they act on H, but now I can take copies of them, infinitely many, AI, such that AI acts on the ith copy of my space H in this infinite tensor product. So we can realize, and we can realize the canonical commutation relations in the infinite case on this space, on this Hilbert space, by operators where I'm just taking copies of the A's, so I call them AI. So this AI is now the A, but the action is just on the ith component in my infinite tensor product. So this is one tensor. Everywhere else, it acts as the identity, and at the ith factor, it acts as A. Tensor 1, tensor 1, and so on. And so this A here is the ith position. Good. And of course, one has to check that all this makes sense. But I mean, this is quite straightforward. This operator, it's clear how to define this on this infinite tensor product. It just on the elementary tensors, it really acts on this position, and this goes over to linear combinations and to the completion. And of course, it should also be clear that if I take here an AI and AJ at different positions, then those operators should commute. They will commute. So I get here realizations of operators where for a fixed I, they satisfy exactly the relations as they satisfied in a one-dimensional case. And if I take them for different indices, I and j, then they just commute. And that's exactly what the CCR infinity is asking for, that I have infinitely many copies of CCR of 1 where the different copies commute among themselves. Yeah, okay, so I have this here, and now, of course, I have this realization of CCR infinity on each of the kn's. So this I can make for any choice of n, and now I'm claiming that if n is different from m, those representations are actually not equivalent. So that's the interesting thing here. So I have here representations of the CCR infinity. I have it on each of the kn, I can do this. And I'm claiming representations on kn and on km are not equivalent as soon as n is different from m. Yeah. Okay, and maybe I draw again this kind of picture for the infinite case, just to maybe give you kind of idea before then I maybe give a more rigorous argument. So what I'm doing here is I'm taking the infinite tensor product of this situation. So I have here my space, L2 space, in this setting I have the vacuum, and then I have psi 1, psi 2, and so on, and I'm taking the tensor product of this infinitely often with itself. And so on. Okay, and now, in order to make the tensor product, I have to specify a vector in each of those copies. And now I'm specifying, I just take one vector and I always take the same. So I can make the K0, for example, there I'm taking the vacuum. So I'm taking in each of those guys, I'm taking the vacuum vector. And in a sense, my tensor product is now around the vacuum vector, where I can perturb the vacuum vector a little bit. But what essentially the whole idea is that I can, in this representation, I cannot perturb it so much that in any copy of those, I will go to one of the other ones. So for example, this here would be the K0. this would be 1, 2, this would be 3. So if I take in each component the psi 3 as my vector in the construction of the tensor product, then here I would have my infinite tensor product, which essentially is around the vector psi 3, where in each of the components I have the vector psi 3 as somehow the basic vector, and then I can make perturbations around this. But the point is, the perturbations which I can make are somehow local. Of course, I can in each component I can go from here to here by applying maybe the creation operator 3 times, but I cannot apply operators which in this infinitely many things change everywhere psi 0 to psi 3. So this situation here is so far away from this situation that the operators which I have at my disposal are not able to do this. Okay, and of course, maybe you can ask, so we had one representation of the CCR infinity, which was given by working on a full Fock space, and of course this was the situation where we started from a vacuum. We had a vacuum, and then we had the creation operators, which generated us all possibilities. So this representation, which we had on the bosonic Fock space, this is exactly this case zero, where we worked. Essentially, our basic vector was an omega, which of course is the tensor product of all these situations here. Okay, so maybe let me also write this down. So our Fock space representation corresponds to the representation on K0. So this was this one. Yeah, but now I'm claiming, okay, instead of the vacuum, we could also take, let's say, the psi 3 as somehow an operator from which we start. And then, I'm claiming this will be very different from this one. Yeah, and so I still owe you the main argument, which really shows that I cannot somehow go from here to here. And this will be... Will be this kind of super selection rules, which I now should make more precise.